There are more than two things that can happen with inequalities. So I made it a point when I taught you this the other day, a couple of days ago, that I didn't want to talk about it because I wanted you just to practice. Hopefully, you've been practicing. I didn't check your Delta math scores, but like I posted on Canvas, you should have that assignment done before tomorrow. And today is now tomorrow. So, or tomorrow is now today. I don't know how you say that, but I assume at this point that you're done with that you got all whatever I asked, 20, whatever. And that you now know perfectly well when to put a splitter, when to put a squisher, how to execute a splitter, how to execute a squisher. Like that was the purpose of that assignment, was just to get that drilled in, which is which and how do I do it. So if you're not done, you should get it done. Assuming that you are, then I have to introduce now the two other cases. And I say the two, there are more things that can start to happen if we throw variables on the other side, just so you know. But for today, if we just stick with the normal formatting of the inequalities, there are now two new things that can happen. We call them special cases. So let's get to it. So at this point in time, you know the drill. So like if you had negative 3 times the absolute value of 5x minus 121 plus 6 is greater than negative 30. Actually, let's just do 36. I'm sorry about that. I apologize for switching it up on you. So this just looks like a regular old problem. And as I've said, you wouldn't look at it and pass judgment as to whether it's a squisher or a splitter, right? Because we don't have the thing by itself yet. So business as usual, we would subtract 6 from both sides. And we would get negative 3 times the absolute value of a whole bunch of stuff that we don't care about at this point is greater than 36 minus 6, which is 30, right? So again, it just still feels like we're marching on towards normal spot here. And then what do? Next, we divide by negative 3. So if we divide by negative 3 and divide by negative 3, cancel those out, we're left with the absolute value of stuff that, quite frankly, I still don't care about, is what? Exactly what it is less than negative 10. And what would you do from this point? You would write no solution. Very good. So here's the deal, is that we have to now stop and think about what makes something a special case. And you know how, good job, Sutter, by the way. You know that absolute values behave in a very predictable manner. The absolute value of something never gives out negatives. And when I say, I don't take that word lightly, when I say never, I mean like never. So this machine, this red machine here, this absolute value says, I'll do whatever. But one thing I will never do is give you a negative answer. So you could sit here all day long and try to find X's that when you plug them in and then take the absolute value, you get an answer that's less than negative 10. It is literally impossible. So because of this negative number over here, we have entered the realm of the special cases, and we can now say that this problem has no solution. You don't take that kind of stuff lightly around here. To say something has no solution is pretty bold. You know, to say something's impossible is pretty bold, but this problem is impossible to solve. You could spend a trillion human lifetimes and you're never going to find a number that makes this happen. Does that make sense? Okay. So now, in addition to thinking about splitters and squishers, a new combatant has entered the arena. We now have to consider that when we get to that crossroads, when we get the absolute value by itself, if the number on the other side is a negative, we have to consider now that this isn't so much a math problem as it is a common sense problem, right? Do you understand that so far? Okay, let's take a look at the other side of the coin. So let's say we had negative times the absolute value of 5x plus 1 minus 9 is less than. Why do I keep doing this? Stop doing what I'm doing. I don't know if I need rest or something like that. Let's do this. Keep talking myself into writing dumb things. I apologize. So, I mean, procedurally, if you've been practicing, this is light work, right? Let's add 9 and get 29. So we have the opposite of the absolute value of stuff that I still don't care about is less than 29, right? After that? Right. And again, that's where we don't want to be slowed down by ghetto understanding of the stuff we should have already learned, right? When we divide by a negative, we've got to give respect to all the things that happen. When you divide by a negative like this, or a negative one, if that makes you uncomfortable, then you're left with the absolute value of stuff that I still don't care about. I could write anything in there in this problem. It doesn't matter, right? Because the less than changes to a greater than, and 29 divided by negative 1 is negative 29. And by definition, because of this, this is now a special case. Again, when you throw absolute values and negative numbers together, you're in a special sort of situation where you have to think about what does and does not make sense. What would you say we should do from here?
Anything that's above negative 9 would be correct. As long as it's 0, then negative 9 would be correct, right?
Let me ask you this. Every one of you right now in this room could pick a different X. Not that you have to, because I know when I do stupid games like that, some people are like, just don't play stupid games. But hypothetically, every one of you could pick a different X. Sutter could pick negative 64,329,156.5 repeating, right? Javin could pick 2, right? Serenity could pick negative 9.1. Bryce could pick 0. It doesn't matter. Everyone in this room could pick a different value for X. And if I had you, if I were some sort of like drill sergeant, I could have you each put your own X's right there. Every one of you. And multiply by 5. Don't care what you get. And then you could add 1. I don't care what you get. But the final step is what's important. The last thing you would do, every one of you, is take the absolute value of whatever you get. So everything works. It's like that, but we have to say it a little bit differently. That's exactly the right idea. There are infinitely many solutions to this, but the way we want to write in this case is we want to say all real numbers. There's a difference between infinite solutions and all real numbers. Infinite means that there are infinitely many that work, but that doesn't necessarily imply that all numbers work, which is kind of like brain exploded kind of a concept. But in this case, literally every real number in the world would work. You could spend 100,000 trillion human lifetimes doing nothing all day, but picking X numbers to put into this problem. And every single time, what you get for that yellow absolute value, I money back guarantee you, will be greater than negative 29. Do we agree? Because what's the lowest the yellow machine is ever going to produce? 0. Ever. It's going to produce a 0 sometimes. Okay. But 0 is greater than negative 29, and so is everything else the yellow machine can produce. So the purpose of today's discussion is that now we have 4 things that can happen. So when we get the absolute value by itself, we have to consider 4 different things. So to summarize this for our notes, and then I'll shut up, let's just do a quick example of what each of the 4 situations will look like so that you can always refer back to it. Okay. So here's scenario number one. And I'm not going to make you go through all the work like the adding and dividing by stuff. Let's just get right to the end. So we've done some work and we wind up with the absolute value of 3x minus 4 is greater than 2. Which of the four scenarios does this fall under? It is a splitter. This is not a special case. Why? Yeah, because 2 is positive. So we're not in the funk zone. You only enter today's new stuff, the funk zone, if the number after the inequality sign at the end is negative. This is normal. This is what you just practiced for an hour or whatever on Delta Math. So this one would be a classic splitter. You would write your two inequalities with the word or in the middle and proceed from there. Okay. How about this one? Right. I know I'm in one of the two weird ones now because when I get the absolute value by itself, there's a negative on the right side. And everything that the absolute value ever makes will be guaranteed greater than negative one. Therefore, this one is an example of all real numbers. If you'd like, as you take more math classes, there's a shorthand symbol in mathematics for the all real numbers. If you want to use it, you can make two vertical lines like this, and then watch where my pen starts over here. You can connect like this and make a capital R. That symbol in math stands for all real numbers. If you want to use it, you're welcome to. Okay. If you don't like it, then just write all real numbers. It's all good. No problem. About this one? How about the absolute value of negative 526x plus 1.8 repeating is less than or equal to 12? It is a squisher. It would kind of suck to solve, huh? But that's not the point of this part of the notes. This part of the notes is just, can I identify you? And because you're a positive number, 12, you're not a funk zone. And because you're a less than, you are a classic squisher. So I'm giving you this as a resource so that this is kind of a one-stop shopping for your notes. Just kind of set it aside, have these four examples, and then when you look back, you can say you're one of those. Okay. And then, of course, you know where I'm headed with this, but let's say we had like the absolute value of m over 2 plus 56, whoop, is less than negative 19. This has no solution, right? Remember that it is literally impossible for the absolute value of anything to ever come out to anything less than 0, let alone less than negative 19, right? So this has no solution. Some other fancy ways to write no solution. One of them is an empty set like this. You can put a circle, not a zero, a circle with a slash all the way through it. That denotes in mathematics a set that is empty. And another way to denote an empty set is to put a curly bracket followed by another curly bracket like this. That is literally a set that is empty. So most people just stick to writing no solution. And I can't say I blame you, but both of these notations also mean a set of numbers that contains no numbers. Nothing's in it. Do you guys have any questions about that? All right. I have a paper assignment for you today, and it will include now the special cases. And I had to do it on the CUDA software because the Delta Math just doesn't give them, and it drives me nuts.
I assume you're done with assignment 22. If not, you'll want to finish that, but then you also want to get this one done too. I am going to keep the recording going, only paused, so that if you have questions, I can put them in here.
Resume. Yep. Okay. Forgot this. So if you get to the end of a problem and the answer is no solution, when you go to make a graph of it, as crazy as you might think this is, here's what you do. You draw a number line. And you move on. Okay, that is your way of showing the world. Look, I have a number line with nothing on it. That is how I graph no solution. And on the other side, if I wanted to graph all real numbers, I draw my number line. So I show the world that I have a number line, and then over the top of it, I shade the entire number line with arrowheads to indicate that everything on the number line is a solution. Sorry for the silliness of that, but yes, no solution still has to be graphed as an empty number line. All real numbers is graphed as a full number line. Got it? All right.